Hey, what's up, family? Pastor Anson McMahon here. Hey, listen, we are so grateful that you're able to take advantage of this Bible resource from Emmaus Church. Every single week, our desire is to preach and teach the scriptures in such a way that is both edifying and encouraging. We want to exalt Jesus, and our desire is that these resources would serve as a supplement to your involvement in a local church wherever you are. It is absolutely critical, according to God's word, that you be involved in a church, connecting in the church, being in relationships within that church, serving the body of Christ, giving generously, involved in a local church. And so we hope this blesses you. And if it does bless you, consider maybe giving to our ministry here at Emmaus Church. You can do that on our app. You can do that on our website. But until then, just know we're praying for you, and we truly do hope this blesses your life.
Well, good morning. It is great to be worshiping with you today. My name is Travis, one of the pastors here. And if it is your first time, I just want to extend a special welcome to you. We are so thrilled you are here checking things out, worshiping with us, and we would love a chance to connect with you and just reach out and say thank you so much for your visit. So if you do me a huge favor, you can connect with us a couple different ways. One, you can just text the word welcome to the number you see on the screens now. Just pull out your phone even right now and just text the word welcome to that number, or you've got little blue cards in the card pockets in front of you. Feel free to take one of those, fill it out. You can drop it in the box right over there by the lobby doors. Either way, we would just love a chance to reach out and say thank you so much for your visit. So if you do me that favor, I would so appreciate that. And I would encourage you, stop by our Welcome Center. As you leave today, we have a free gift we would love to put in your hands. Now, church, we're going to transition into our time of worship. So if you don't mind, let's go ahead and stand together as we get ready to sing to our Savior. I want to read this passage for us. This comes from Psalm 30, verses 3 through 4. It says, O Lord, you have brought up my soul from Sheol. You restored me to life from among those who go down to the pit. Sing praises to the Lord, O you, his saints, and give thanks to his holy name. Our God is certainly deserving of our praises, of our worship, of our adoration. Isn't that right, church? So let's sing together and worship our God and Savior.
I've searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. And you came along and put me back together. Hearing your love, sing, oh, there's nothing better. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. Lord, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, I know it's true. The God of the valley. Hey.
hopeless. I was hopeless. I knew I was lost. Death and darkness were my only songs. I needed someone. I needed someone to come rescue me. The mercy heard my plea.
Lord, you found me, you healed me, you called me from the grave. You gave me a real love, I thank you, Jesus. You washed my sins away. Oh, now I'm living like I'm forgiven. You came to set me free. What your mercy did for me.
You gave the guilty for my guilty stains. And now I'm living day to day by your grace. So excuse me if I can't get time in my eyes. Cause I know that I
How we doing, Emmaus Church family? Everybody good?
Yeah.
Awesome, awesome. Hey, so first things first, if you're new here, my name's Anson, lead pastor here, and excited to be back. Just want to, if you are new here, I just want to let you know, I don't typically go for the purple, okay? It's not my first choice. I don't usually walk in a closet and go, where's that purple outfit? This is for the kids, okay? This is for the kids. Like a bunch of us just got back from kids camp and student camp this past week. It was amazing. Want to say thank you on behalf of everybody that went, every kid, every student, every leader. Thank you for those of you who prayed, those of you who wore those wristbands, and some of you had 2, 3, 5, right? Had tons of, you just looked like Mr. T out there, right? Praying for everybody. And we want to say thank you for that, man. The Lord richly blessed us. Had one kid and one student that I know of trust in Jesus while away at camp, which was awesome. And so, thanks for praying, because God heard it, and I survived. I survived. I made it. I made it, man. I have not recovered at all. I got back on Thursday, or actually Wednesday. I don't know. What year is it? I don't know. I got back one day, and I was like, you know what I realized? Here's what I realized. I realized it's a bit challenging to prepare a sermon at kids' camp. It's a little bit challenging, right? And so I got back, and I was like, I'm going to do it tomorrow. I'm going to rest up. I'm going to do it tomorrow. And I woke up the next day, and I was like, I'm still not awake. I'm still not able. And so I waited till the next day and the next day, and hopefully the Lord gave something. I am a little bit concerned, though, because in seminary, in my preaching class, I had a professor say, hey, a good sermon has 1 to 3 points. I got 9, okay? So, that's not a joke, all right? So I hope you brought paper and you're ready for this. Let's dig in. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're going to pick it up in verse 35. Pastor Travis took us through verse 34 last week, and it was awesome. And we're going to pick it up here at a really critical point, man. And before we dive in, I'll just kind of start with this. Back a couple weeks ago, my wife Heather had signed us up for the 4th of July weekend race in Atlanta. Okay, so she signed us up. Thank you for laughing. I appreciate that. Thank you. And she signed us up. And the problem with that, listen, we've done it a few times before in the past. Okay, we've done it a few times before. The problem though this year is that. I've done nothing this year, okay? Like COVID was a thing, and COVID shut down my gym for a few months, right? And then after my gym opened up, I decided I don't think I want to go back, right? There are other things I'd prefer to do, like eat Cheetos and do nothing, right? And so I was totally out of a routine, and so I wasn't disciplined, and I'm trying to get back into it now, but for the longest time, I was just so not disciplined at all. And so the problem was typically when we've done this race before, you know, we, you know, trained or at least ran a couple laps beforehand, and I did nothing. Absolutely nothing. But honestly, in my arrogance, I'm thinking, how tough can this be, right? Over 6 miles up hills in downtown Atlanta in 100-degree heat, what can possibly go wrong? This is fine. Matter of fact, I kind of made this commitment going into it. And by going into, I mean like the morning of, as we're driving there, I just sort of made this commitment. I was like, you know what? Not only am I going to do this, I'm going to go faster than I ever have before. I am. I'm going to make up for me being lazy the past year. I'm going to break my own personal record. Like the record I have in this, I'm going to break it. I'm going all in on this thing, man. I just don't even care. And I'm going to prove to myself I can do this. And I'm going to make up for the fact that I haven't gone to the gym in like a year. And so sure enough, like there we are, and my wife and I are ready, and we're with this sea of people, and it gets to our our squad, our group of people that we're getting ready to run with, and we get to the line, right? We get to the line, and as soon as we cross the line, I just sprinted, like I'm like Usain Bolt going for the gold. My wife's screaming, "Where are you going? What are you doing? You're going to hurt yourself. What are you doing? What are you doing?" And I'm like, I just feel so fast. I'll just meet you at the finish line. I feel so fast. And I just went. I have my earbuds in. I'm listening to my Hall & Oates. I'm weaving in and out of people. I'm going to do this. I'm committed. I'm good. If I'm here, I'm going to give it my all. I'm going all in on this thing, man. Six and a half miles later, whatever it was, I crossed the finish line. And the bad news is I didn't make it under an hour. I wanted to make it under an hour. I didn't make it under an hour. I made it 1 hour, 1 minute, 4 seconds and broke my personal record. Broke it. Shattered it. No training. No nothing. No training. Just me and the Holy Spirit. Now, So then I finish and I'm walking in Piedmont Park where the race ends, and I'm like, okay, I got to go get my t-shirt now, because you finish and you get that t-shirt. And I'm walking to get the t-shirt, and all of a sudden I get this sensation. It was like my calves exploded. I collapse onto my knees in Piedmont Park, and then I fall over and I'm laying down. It was like my whole body became one cramp. Like the whole thing is, and I'm laying there and I'm writhing in pain and I can't move. I had people walking up to me going, do you need a medic? Are you okay? Do you need a medic? And I'm like, no, I don't. I'm just a really stupid 43-year-old man. I don't need a medic, right? It was like my whole body was saying, why are you so dumb? Right? What were you thinking? Right? My entire body revolted and said, that was a really, 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 really bad idea. Now, here's why I tell you that story, family. Think about this. How many of y'all, a little show of hands here, okay? How many of y'all have ever had days, you've had those days when you just sort of wanted to trade in your body for a new model? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Right? I mean, we all get this, right? We all understand the tension here of getting to a moment in our lives where we're like, man, you know what? My body has limits, and it seems like the limits are getting stricter, right? It seems like the older I get, the fewer things I can accomplish without, you know, pulling a hammy or blowing out a knee. It's just like, man, I have these limitations. We all know what it's like to experience the vast limitations of our bodies. I mean, think about it. So some of us in here, we feel like we're always sick, right? Some of us in here, we're always sick. We're always struggling. We always are coughing or sneezing or got a thing, or your allergies are crazy, right? Some random flower blooms in Montana and you get allergies in Georgia, right? It's just like you're very sensitive to stuff. And we get sick. Some of us know what it's like to have chronic pain. You just feel like you're always hurting, right? You got elbow stuff and shoulder stuff and head stuff and just always got stuff, right? You're always in pain. Like, I got an uncle who's had, get this, he's had 15, I'm not making this up, 15 back surgeries in his life and is still in pain, right? So some of us know this, we know what this is, man, but this chronic pain, right? Hey, how many of y'all are like me where it's weird, man. Some mornings you'll wake up hurting and you're like, I didn't do anything. Had a few mornings ago, I woke up, my knee is throbbing. I'm like, how do you get sleep injuries, man? Like, how does that work? Like, I blew out a knee sleeping. What just happened, right? We got these limits in our bodies, man, right? So some of us have these quirks about our bodies that we don't really enjoy, we don't really like. Like for me, for instance, I mean, I have a few of them, but one of the things that I really can't stand is, I don't know if you're aware of this, I sweat, okay? I'm like a chronic sweater. I just have the spiritual gift of sweating anywhere. I sweat in the winter. I sweat when it's cold. I just sweat all the time. And it drives me crazy. Like, I can't stand it. I can't stand it. Like, just once in my life, I would love to be able to preach a sermon without getting to the end of it looking like I lost a water balloon fight, right? I mean, I'd just love to be able to be dry. But I don't. I got these quirks. We have these quirks in our bodies. Back a few weeks ago, I had an ingrown toenail. What a blessing that is, amen? Right? Don't you love those? Right? I had an ingrown toenail. My wife and I were traveling. We were at the airport in Atlanta, and she's like, hurry, we're going to miss our flight. And I'm like, I'm trying, right? And I'm hobbling around, and it hurts. I have no idea how I got it. Just have these, in pain. What about COVID, right? COVID, dude, we just came out of a year. It's like you got to wear a mask. You can't go see grandma. You feel like you can't do anything. Why? I mean, think about this, family. Let's be honest. This past year and a half has been like a really powerful but also very depressing example of how limited our bodies actually are, right? We're like, stay away, put on your mask. Why? Because we're all freaked out about what's going to happen to our bodies in this fallen world. Now, incidentally, beloved, this is exactly what brings us to the end of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, okay? And if you were here last Sunday when Pastor Travis preached right before this, then you understand, kind of, you got to run and start to what's going on. But if you didn't, you got to understand this. Incredibly, so Paul's writing this letter, right? We've been in 1 Corinthians now for a year, and Paul's writing it to a church with all kinds of issues, and it's really jacked, and they're fighting and divided and immature and everything else. Paul's also answering questions that these people had and issues that are going on in the church. But now we get to 1 Corinthians 15. And amazingly, Paul, think about this. Pastor Paul has just declared to these people here in Corinth that even though one day inevitably their bodies are going to, you know, they're going to break down like a 2006 Honda Accord and they're just going to die, right? They're going to die. Like, it doesn't matter that there's coming a day where your body is going to die. But Paul has incredibly declared to these people that even though that's true, that they're going to die, there is also eventually coming a day when they will rise up from the grave. I mean, let's just hang on that for a second. This distinctly Christian idea that believers, those who are in Christ, man, though we die, as Jesus says in John chapter 11, though we die, yet shall we live, that we'll come walking out of the grave at his command. And specifically, one of the things that Paul said was this. It was found in verse 20, and Pastor Travis talked about it last week. I don't know if you caught this or not, but in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 20, Paul makes a statement. He says, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Did you catch that? So Paul's got this distinctly Christian idea. He's like, hey, guess what? Here's the really cool news. Jesus Christ came out of the grave. Here's the other cool news. That was just the first fruits. He was the first of many who will rise up out of the grave. Now, here's what you gotta understand. Hearing this mind-blowing truth, I mean, this radical, extreme truth, after hearing this, guess what, family? These people in Corinth, you know what happens? They obviously have a few follow-up questions. Wow, That's quite the idea, Paul. Now, let me ask you some follow-up questions here, and you got to understand why, okay? You got to understand why these people would have some follow-up questions to this radical idea that believers, followers of Jesus, though we die, will one day come out of the grave, okay? Here's the reason why they would have these questions, family. You got to understand this amazing idea that one day people who know Jesus would rise from the grave, would come out of the tomb, so to speak, would rise again. This was radically different from anything that these people had a concept for when it came to the afterlife. These were Greeks. They grew up with the school of thought of people like Aristotle and Socrates and Plato. And Plato in particular, man, his whole idea was, you know what? Your body is a container for your soul until you die. And the best thing is just to be over with it. So we're just kind of biding time right now. And then one day the body's going to die. Phew, that's good, because everything, all the created matter and stuff, is just a really bad thing and corruptible. And so one day you're going to die and your soul's just going to sort of float out there and do soul stuff, right? That's what your soul is. Your soul is the good thing. Your soul is the thing that's going to live forever. It's just going to be out there somewhere doing its thing. That was this Platonic idea, this Platonic teaching in Greece. And so they didn't have a framework for this idea that somehow the body would live forever. Like, they got the soul lives forever. I'm tracking with you, Paul. But the idea that the body would live forever for them was just crazy to think about. And so you got to follow this, family, because what's interesting is the same thing is true for a lot of Christians today. What's fascinating is how many Christians I meet and I talk to on a regular basis who kind of believe that our body's going to die, our soul's going to sort of go somewhere and do soul stuff, and that's just going to kind of be, our soul is out there doing its thing, but they have no concept whatsoever for this bodily resurrection, even today, and that was these people. So consequently, family, because this picture that Pastor Paul has just painted for them of what the afterlife, so to speak, is actually going to look like for believers, because this is so different from everything that they ever thought they knew about the afterlife, they got follow-up questions, and Paul addresses those in verse 35. So watch this. So again, Paul's just said, hey, guess what? Jesus rose again, and so will you one day, Christians. But then we get to verse 35, and Paul says, but someone will ask, How were the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? Paul's like, I get it. Some of y'all hear that and you're going, well, how does that even work? And what's the body going to be like? And you have questions, right? And so you hear a truth. Think about this. You hear a truth about the Lord, but you respond with questions. Now, I want to go ahead and get to point number one right now, because I feel like this is a really important thing to point out about this text. And this is one of the things I really love about God, and I really think is cool about the Lord we worship and we sing to and we're all about in here today. Okay, one of the things that I love about God is this. Here's point number one. Get this. I hope you know this, family. Point number one is this. Number one, God is big enough for our questions. Totally big enough for our questions. I love that about God, man. I love that our God is so secure in who he is that he's not threatened when his people go, oh, I hear you, but I got a question. Or God, I hear what you say about yourself, but you know what? Sometimes what you say about yourself doesn't necessarily line up with what I'm seeing over here. And so help me to get this, right? Family, you read the scriptures. You read the scriptures and you're going to find that over and over and over and over and over again throughout the scriptures, men and women are asking really hard, earthy, raw questions of the Lord. And I love that the Lord didn't respond by going, who do you think you are to ask me a question? I'm God. Who do you, you know what? Boom, lightning bolt, there's your answer. He doesn't do that. Some of y'all grew up in traditions, man. You sort of grew up in and around the church, and you sort of grew up in a tradition where you were kind of, maybe if not explicitly taught this, it was sort of implicit. Like you actually grew up believing that you couldn't ask questions in church. You can't ask questions. You just got to, it's said, and you just got to, okay, I'm good. And you can't ask follow-up questions, right? So the preacher says something about death, and you can't ask, whoa, or says something about prayer, or says something about gender, or says something about sexuality, or says something about eternal life. And you can't go, whoa, help me understand. Some of y'all grew up thinking you can't ask questions of the Lord. That's not biblical Christianity. I'll prove it to you. I love that David says this. How'd you like to hear this question asked in a church one day in Psalm chapter 10, verse 1? David himself says, why, O Lord, do you stand far away? Why do you hide yourself in times of trouble? Whew. David's like, hey, God, here's what I don't get. Looks like the world's on fire. Don't see you doing much about it. What's up with that? And God's secure enough to hear that. Y'all, listen, that's a song that was sung in church. That's how secure God is. Put your questions about me in a song that you can sing in church. That's how secure he is. How about Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 2? Habakkuk, the prophet, says this, O Lord, how long shall I cry for help and you will not hear, or cry to you violence and you will not save? Anybody ever felt that way about the Lord? God, I'm really struggling because I've been praying about something for years now and you still haven't done a thing about it that I can see. What's up with that? Remember John the Baptizer in the Gospels sends some dudes to Jesus to go, hey man, John's got a question. Are you really the guy we were supposed to be waiting for, or is there like somebody else? Like even John the Baptizer's doubting, and I love that Jesus doesn't respond by going, tell John to watch his mouth because I'm the king. He doesn't say that. He gives him an answer. He sends him an answer. Beloved, God's big enough for your questions. Some of y'all think you can't ask questions, you can't ask follow-up questions in church. Let me tell you something. The church is where you're supposed to ask the follow-up questions. Don't take your questions about life, the world, gender, sexuality, death, eternal life. Don't take those questions to the culture. Take them to God. Take them to the Word. And I love the fact that Paul just dropped this incredible truth of the resurrection on these saints in Corinth. But now he says, look, I get it. Some of y'all got questions. Understand. Why? Right? So look at again what he says here. He says, but someone will ask, how were the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? And then Paul gives his answer. He says, you foolish person. Don't you love Paul's bedside manner as a pastor? Isn't that awesome? I was reading this week. I was tripped out, right? I was thinking, man, can you imagine me doing a counseling session in my office with one of y'all? Pastor, I just got some questions about the Bible, and I was just wondering about that, blah, 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 blah. And I look at him and go, you moron. What is that, dude? What's that? So what's important is, like, you have to understand the whole of Scripture to understand what's actually going on here. Okay, so Paul isn't calling some particular person a fool. That's not what he's doing. You have to understand what Paul's actually doing here. What Paul's saying here, and you follow this as you get you start to get this as you follow the idea here. What Paul's doing here is he's acknowledging the fact. He's saying, hey guys, here's what you need to remember. Like, some of you are struggling. You have these big follow-up questions. You're like, how can this happen? What could this even look like? How is this even possible? He says, you need to understand that compared to the Lord, you're a fool. You need to know your role here for a second. That's what Paul's pointing out. This idea that compared to the Lord, like family, how many of y'all know that when it comes to the way we think and the way God thinks, he's playing a different game than us? Right? We're not even in the same league. He's up here. I mean, it's what Isaiah says, right? Isaiah chapter 55, verse 8. For my thoughts, the Lord says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. Paul's like, listen, you can't enter into this thing with your linear thinking going, well, I've never seen anybody rise from the dead, so since I've never seen it, it can't be possible, it can't be true. He's like, you need to understand, like, compared to the Lord and the way he thinks and who he is, you're a total fool here, which, by the way, family, brings us to point two. Point two is really important. Point two is this. Write this down, family. Number two, God's thoughts are higher than your thoughts. They just are. And so when we struggle with these concepts or ideas about God or Scripture, the very best thing we can do when we have questions about the Lord is to approach the Lord in humility. Not pride and arrogance, in humility. His thoughts are higher than ours. His ways are higher, further, beyond ours. And so Paul begins to unpack what this means in verse 36. Watch this. He said, but someone will ask, how were the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? You foolish person. What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And what you sow is not the body that is to be, but a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body. For not all flesh is the same, but there is one kind for humans, another for animals, another for birds, and another for fish. There are heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but the glory of the heavenly is of one kind, and the glory of the earthly is of another. Now watch this, family. There is one glory of the sun and another glory of the moon and another glory of the stars, for stars differ from star in glory. Now watch this. Paul's saying this. Paul's saying, listen, you're trying to figure this out on your own with your own linear thinking based on everything you've ever seen. He said, you need to understand something about the Lord. Don't we know this about God? God creates whatever he wants to create. God does whatever he wants to do. God is powerful and can pull off whatever he wants. And it doesn't have to, like, fit inside of our minds to understand how he does it. He just totally does it. For example, think the example that Paul uses is this. And I'll kind of put it into our modern day terms. How many of y'all, when you were in kindergarten, one day teacher gave you a styrofoam cup and some dirt? And then she gave you a seed, right? And then you put the little seed in the dirt, you buried the little seed in the dirt, and then you put it up on the windowsill in the classroom. Anybody ever do this? Anybody ever done this right at some point? And you put it in the dirt. And some of y'all out there, you went to public school in Macon like I did, and you did this in 10th grade. But you put a little. But you put a little seed in the dirt, right? And then you water the dirt, and then you're just sitting there going, well, nothing's gonna happen. What's gonna happen? What's gonna happen? And then eventually what happens? There's like this little green thing sprouts up, right? Remember? This green thing sprouts up and then it starts to grow. And next thing you know, you got like a tomato plant. And here's what's crazy. That tomato plant is a completely different thing than the seed it was. Completely different. It was the same thing, but then that seed died, right? It died. And now you have something that you couldn't even fathom that seed could become. You're like, what in the world? Listen, this is the picture that Paul uses here. He's like, listen, guys, you got to understand, this resurrected body that we're talking about, that this body that comes out of the grave by the power of God's Holy Spirit, eventually when Jesus commands it to, it's different than you have any framework for.
It's different. Like, I can't even possibly explain. It's just different. And think about this. Isn't this exactly what we observe in the scriptures? Think about what we observe from the resurrected, glorified body of Jesus in the Gospels. Remember? It's like similar but different. You read the Gospels and you read about Jesus post-resurrection, comes out of that grave. What do we read about Jesus? Well, first of all, we read that his disciples recognized him. So he wasn't like completely looking different, right? It's not like you're gonna, you know, you come out of the grave and now you got a, you know, Tom Brady jawline and just, you know, right? He's like, no, who are you? Oh, hey, you're Bill. Hey. No. They recognized him. So he was recognizable. We also know he was physical. Remember what Jesus says? Hey, touch my wounds, touch my body, touch it. You can touch it. By the way, I love that. Do you remember this part post-resurrection? There's a point where Jesus looks at his disciples and says, you got something to eat? I want something to eat. At the end of the Gospel of John, he's sitting down on a beach with Peter and with John, and he's cooking fish. So he eats. But at the same time, it's different. It's beyond what we can imagine. Remember the part he walks through a wall? Pulls that little Star Trek thing, right? Just like, whoa, he'll suddenly appear somewhere and then he'll suddenly disappear. And listen, the scriptures never chalk that up to being a miracle. It just seems to be one of the things that a glorified, resurrected body just sort of does. Do you see it? And so follow this, family. The point that Paul's making right here is this. He's saying, listen, you got to understand, God is God and he totally knows what he's doing, man. So before you come at it with your questions of how can this be, you got to understand, first of all, he's playing a different game than you, man. So he can do whatever he wants to do. He's able to pull anything off. Like, he's not limited by the things in your mind that you're limited by. And this is really important to point out because, you know, for a whole host of reasons, but here's one. I remember, see if this sounds familiar to you. I remember I had a Nana. She had my grandma, lived out in Texas. My Nana, she's dead now. My Nana, years ago, when I was a little kid, I remember she made our entire family swear that when she died, they would not have her cremated. You better not have me cremated. You better swear. I'll get out of contract. Don't have me cremated. Don't have me cremated. Everybody's like, "Why, Nana, why don't you want to be cremated?" She said, well, because one day Jesus is going to return and the dead are going to rise. And how's he going to find me? You can take me out of the Atlantic Ocean and scatter my ashes everywhere. And Jesus is going to come back and go, where's Myrtle? It's like a missing jigsaw puzzle piece. Anybody seen her here? Right? She's like, like, she literally believed this. But this is why what Paul's saying here is so important. Paul's like, listen, you got to understand, God does whatever God wants to do. And he's not limited by all your stuff. Remember what John the Baptizer said to the Pharisees in the Gospel of Matthew? He said, listen, the Lord can make children for Abraham out of these rocks right here. Not bound by your crazy limitations, right? And then we get to verse 42. Watch this. Watch what happens in verse 42, family. It says, so is it with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. Watch this. I love this. It is sown in weakness. It's raised in power. Which brings us to the third point. This is really good news for you old, weak people like me. Number three, your resurrection body will be strong, not weak. Paul says, it's sown in weakness. It is raised in power. Can I get an amen from all the people feeling old today? All the people feeling weak. I don't know about you, man. So recently, here's what I've started to notice. There are things I used to be able to do fairly easily, and now they're hard. Like, I used to be able to do stuff, and it was, you know, whatever, and now they're exhausting, and I find myself getting tired. I find myself getting winded. I find myself, my energy level depleted faster than it used to be, right? For example, this past week, I went as a chaperone to kids' camp. Now you understand the bags under my eyes, right? You starting to get it? I mean, And family, listen, can I just be clear? Let me just say this. Camp was amazing. It was absolutely amazing. I'd go again in a heartbeat. And listen, we have some incredible kids in our church, and some of you men in particular in this church need to pray about going to camp with our kids next summer, because let me tell you something, these kids need men who love Jesus in their lives. They need it. And I loved every minute of it, but that being said, I was reminded of the fact that I am not a spring chicken. I got winded faster than, I mean, here I am. I'm trying to keep up with my five boys that I'm responsible for in my cabin. Where's my boys at? Well, I'm missing one. Why is he on the roof, right? And you're just like, you're trying to run around and keep up with, I'm trying to explain to my boys at night why it's unacceptable to throw a kickball at the other guy's face while he sleeps, right? I'm doing an investigation. One day I did an investigation in my room to try to find out who used my bath towel to dry up their Dr. Pepper on the floor. And I'm trying to, who did it, guys? Seriously, I'm putting lamps in faces. Who, right? That was a joke, parents. I didn't really do that. I'm trying to make sure that my kids put something other than chocolate on their lunch plate, right? It's just like the whole week you're just trying to do stuff. And that was just the first day. That's the first day. And so, like, seriously, the very first night, I go to bed and I'm laying in my bed and the boys are laying in their bunks and they just keep talking. Lights out comes, but that doesn't matter to them. They just keep talking, right? They're talking about what kind of slime is the best. They're talking about what kind of animal is fastest, right? They're talking about what kind of car they want to get one day. And they just keep talking. And finally, I said, boys, listen, Pastor Sleepy, here's what I'll do. If you stop talking, I'll give you a dollar. That's where I sunk. I'll give you a dollar. I'll pay you to let me sleep. I'm that exhausted. The next morning, I wake up. I'm at breakfast. I finally got all five of my kids to breakfast. My wife texts me. She hadn't left for student camp quite yet. She texts me, how'd your first night go? Are you awake this morning? Are you doing good this morning? I sent her this picture right here. Where's that picture at? I sent her that. I didn't even say anything. I sent her that picture. She said, is that Bang energy drink and a black coffee? I said, no, it's an energy cocktail is what it is. I'm just like mixing drinks, right? It's just like, I got to have some. And I drank it. Matter of fact, that was my second cup of black coffee right there and my Bang energy drink. I drank all that stuff. And y'all, I'm coming out of breakfast and I'm bouncing around. And one of the leaders said, man, Anson, last night you were really tired. It looks like you caught your second wind. I said, no, I had an energy cocktail. I'm feeling good. The rest of the camp, I'm dancing around with Paula Abdul. It's great, right? It's just, but that, I needed it. There was a day where I didn't need that. I just couldn't function without it. I mean, here's the point, family. I'm not young anymore, right? My energy gets depleted. Like, things are happening. I get weak. And follow this. This is exactly why what Pastor Paul is saying right here is such good news for the Christian. That's why this is such good news, family. According to 1 Corinthians 15, there is coming a day when I will have a brand new, glorified, resurrected body that will never, ever, ever, ever get weak again. What? It will never, and by the way, here's what's important to understand. That doesn't just mean it will never get physically weak. It also means it will never be morally weak. There's coming a day in my glorified, resurrected body where I will never, ever, ever be tempted again. I'll never war against that temptation and fall to that temptation ever. Can you imagine? Now watch verse 44, beloved. Check this out. Look at this. It says, it is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. Now, incidentally, family, the really important point that Pastor Paul is reminding us of right here is this. You are not just one part. You are two parts. You are not just like some random mammal walking around, and when you die, it's blackout, it's gone, you're just nothing forevermore. No, you're not just one part, you're two parts. You are body and soul. your body and your soul. Incidentally, this is exactly why Pastor Paul over in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, remember there's that moment where Paul says, listen, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Right? To be away from the body, he says, is to be at home with the Lord. Meaning, here's how it works, beloved Christian, those whose faith is in Jesus, talking specifically to you right now. Here's how it works. One day your body will give out and die, and at the moment you die, that very next moment, your soul will be in the presence of the Lord. That's where your soul's going to be. Your soul's going to be with him. And then one day, Jesus Christ will return, and your soul will be reunited to your resurrected body forever. Glorified body forever. That's how this whole deal works. Now follow this. Watch this. Look at verse 45. Check out this, family. He says, thus it is written. And I love this, by the way, theologically. This is the cool stuff that Paul does. Paul is always like drawing the contrast between Adam and Jesus. He does this earlier on in this chapter. He does this most notably in Romans chapter 5. It's amazing. Watch what Paul does here in verse 45. He says, thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. Don't miss that. Second man is from heaven. It's Jesus, second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also were those who were of the dust. And as is the man of heaven, so also were those who were of heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven. Now, here's what Paul's saying right here, and here's the reason you should get really Pentecostal right now. Here's why this is so good. Paul's saying, listen, you got to understand, first of all, we were all born with a body that's under the curse. That's why you pull hammies. That's why you experience pain. That's why, frankly, you're dying right now. Not to bring the room down, but you're dying right now. You're falling apart right now. You're frail. You're frail, right? We're all born with a body that's under the curse. And listen, it's not because God created it that way. It's because it's been marred by sin. You've got to understand this. It's not because God made you to, like, you know, pull hammies and to experience pain and all that kind of stuff. It's that we've been marred by sin. It's because of sin. Listen, God's perfection, God's shalom, God's perfect goodness, the way that things should be, has been marred by sin. But here's the really good news, family. King Jesus came down from heaven. He came down from heaven. He took on a human body. He lived that life in that human body as a human being. He experienced what it's like to be in a body that experiences pain. He experienced what it was like to be in a body that got sick and got hurt and fell apart. And you know what he did? He lovingly allowed 9-inch spikes to painfully be hammered into his hands and his feet, and he felt every single bit of that pain and of that anguish, and his body died. He really died by crucifixion, but 3 days later, he rose up from the grave, and if you're in Christ, you will too. This is amazing. Like, this is what it means to be Christian? Sign me up, man. This is awesome. And this is a really important thing to talk about, family. Because there seems to be a lot of confusion out there about this. So like, for example, I remember being in college or something, and I used to, you know, every now and then I'd turn on the Christian TV station, right? They have a preacher on there begging for, you know, jet fuel money for their plane and all that crazy stuff, whatever. And I remember there's one particular moment, there was this person on there preaching Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5. So it's this passage that says, by his stripes we've been healed. By Jesus' stripes we've been healed. And the way that they exegeted that passage of scripture was, well, what that means is Jesus died in order to heal you from all your diseases. Jesus died in order to heal you so that you won't get sick. And so you shouldn't, as a Christian, get sick. You shouldn't, as a Christian, get disease. And if you ever do get sick, if you ever do have disease, just claim your healing. Just claim your healing, because by his stripes, you have been healed. And if you have enough faith, you'll be healed. You just see, faith and mustard, you'll be healed. But listen, that is a butchering of that text. That is a butchering of the Bible. How sick and evil is it to look in the eyes of a Christian who's struggling with cancer and say, well, I guess you just don't have enough faith. Claim it. Well, you got to claim it and believe it. Well, claim. How evil and wicked is that? Listen, that is not what that text means. The majority of Christians in here probably know exactly what it's like to have someone you love gets diagnosed with cancer, gets diagnosed with a disease, and you pray for them, and you pray for them, and you pray for them, and they pray, and you even gather elders together, and they anoint oil in the spirit of James, and they still die. Most of us know what it's like to pray and pray and pray and pray and pray and pray and pray for that baby, and the miscarriage still happens. That text does not mean that Jesus died in order that all your diseases and all your stuff would be healed and you just got to name and claim your healing. Instead, family, here's what Paul's teaching us right here in these verses. Here's what you got to understand. Here's why 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is so important and is so good. It's because what we're being reminded of here is this truth, and this is an absolute true truth, and it's this right here. Write this down, family. Here's the next point. Every single Christian will ultimately be healed by Jesus. What is 1 Corinthians chapter 15? It is the final healing we will all experience. No more disease, no more pain, no more tears, no more diagnosis from the doctor, no more blown knees, none of it. It is the final healing. And this actually leads us to another point that Paul's making here, and it's this. Write this down. This is point number 6. I think I lost count. I don't know. It's a point. Here's a point. The next point is this, family. Here's the good news. Listen, here's the good news, Christian. There is coming a day when you will never have to go to another funeral again. I mean, come, Lord Jesus. Can you imagine? Listen. Think about it, man. What is it? What is it about funerals that makes us so sad? What is it about what is it that causes us to just dread the idea of a funeral? Right? Think about this. I mean, never in my life have I ever met a person who said, man, I just really hope I get to go to a funeral this week. I mean, maybe that sociopath exists somewhere out there, but I've never met them. I don't want to. What is it about a funeral, the idea of a funeral that makes us just cringe? You go, oh, no, no, no. And what is it about the idea of immortality and long life that appeals to us so much? Think about it. You know what most of us have in common in here? The vast majority of us in here right now, if not all of us, are doing what we can in our lives to extend our lifespan, right? We want to extend our lifespan. It's why you go to the gym. It's why some of y'all eat that kale junk, right? Drink that wheatgrass, nasty. Nobody does that for fun. Ooh, wheatgrass. No. You do it because you're like, I want to extend my lifespan, right? I want to live a longer time. You do weird yoga stuff because you're just trying to, I want to breathe good. I want to extend my life. What is it? You ever thought about this? What is it about the idea of a funeral that makes, like, by the way, even non-Christians, hang on to that. We're going somewhere with this. Even non-Christians, the idea of a funeral, non-Christians, the idea of long life, even immortality, forever life is, oh, yeah, oh, okay, yeah. What is that? How come we dig superhero movies so much? How many of y'all like superhero movies? Anybody like superhero movies? I love superhero movies. I can't wait. I cannot wait. I cannot wait till December when the new Spider-Man comes out. Can't wait. I'm going to go to Spider-Man. I'm going to go probably with my daughter who has a crush on Tom Holland. And I'm going to go see Spider-Man. And you know what? How lame would it be? Spider-Man starts. 10 minutes into it, Peter Parker gets COVID. Next three hours in the hospital. Why did I spend money on this? I see this out there. What? Right? How lame would it be? Spider-Man swinging through New York City. All of a sudden, boop, blows a knee. Right? He's in traction in the hospital. And that's the movie. That's it. Nobody goes to see that. You know what I'm drawn to? The immortal dude walking around, bullets flying off, no, nothing hurts him, nothing, right, never getting hurt. That's what I want to see. There's something in us that's drawn to that. Why is everybody, including non-Christians, repulsed by the idea of a funeral, really digs the idea of long life, loves the idea of immortality? Why are we drawn to that? Here's why. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11 says, God has set eternity in our hearts. You long for immortality and you're repulsed by death because God, before the foundations of the world, put something there to long for that. Which means this, family, it means this. It leads us to the next point. Just to be clear, just so you understand, your deepest longing is for Jesus. When you long for immortality and long life, you're not longing for immortality and long life. You're longing for Jesus. You're longing for what only Jesus can bring. You're longing for what only Jesus can do. When you're repulsed by death and dying and all that stuff, you know what that is? It's a longing for Jesus to bring what only Jesus can bring: life, healing, restoration, eternity. You see it? The whole world is full of people who don't know Jesus but love the idea of long life and hate the idea of death. Why? Because they don't even understand their deepest longing is for Jesus. God set eternity in there. It's a longing and a thirst that only Christ himself can fill. So now we get to verse 50, and Paul's going to tell us now specifically when this whole new body thing is going to happen. Let me tell you when it's going to happen, because now I've told you what's going to happen, right? Now, the Corinthians had all these questions, right? How's this new body thing going to happen? What do you mean? What kind of body is it going to be? Am I going to be a zombie, right? Just walking around. I've seen Walking Dead one time. That doesn't sound appealing, right? And what is the new body thing? Am I going to be taller? That'd be cool if I was taller. I'd take that. I'd be taller, right? Because right now I'm 6'3", and so if we could just... It's messed up. You know, is cellulite going to be a thing? Like, what's going on? How's this whole new body thing going to work? And so Paul has just answered that, and now he's going to tell us when it's going to happen. Watch verse 50, family. Check this out. He says, I tell you this, brothers and sisters, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. I remember years ago, I preached at this church, and the church above the baby room had that verse. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Praise the Lord. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable and we shall be changed. I was reading one theologian one time and he was like, well, I'll tell you what the trumpet is. He talks about the last trumpet. The trumpet isn't actually a trumpet. It's like an event in history that's going to happen. And then when that event happens, it's going to... You know what the trumpet is? It's a trumpet. It's a trumpet. We are going to hear a trumpet from heaven and it's going to be signaling the grand finale. He's back. He's back for his church. He's back. Get ready. Here we go. You better watch. Better pay attention. He's back. The trumpet's going to sound. And then watch his family for this. Watch. It says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? There is coming a day when a trumpet will sound from heaven and Jesus will command all of his people to rise from the dead, and it's going to happen. is going to happen. Remember in John chapter 11, when Jesus raises his good friend Lazarus from the dead? What's he say to him right before he comes out? Lazarus, come out. Lazarus, come out. I heard one theologian say it was a good thing he said, Lazarus, come out, and not just come out, because if he just said come out, everybody'd be coming out. That's the power of Jesus. Had to specify. And on this day, he will specify every single saint. And on that day, beloved, death will die forever. Death will die. And back years ago, my wife and I were living out in California. I was on staff as a student pastor at a church. This is before we even had kids. And I've had a few moments in my life, or I can probably count on one hand, where it was like truly I would go, that was a Pentecostal Holy Spirit supernatural experience, without a doubt. And I had one on this particular night. It was my wife and I. It was the middle of the night. It was about 3:30 in the morning, and I woke up, and it was just this sadness, just a cloud of sadness, man, and grief. And there was nothing to be sad about. There was nothing. It was like, why am I so sad? What is going on? I got out of bed. I went downstairs. I got my Bible and just with the Lord and with my thoughts and just in my chair in the living room. I have no clue what's going on. Just sad. I'm sitting there for hours. Wife's still asleep. I get a call about 7:45 on my phone, on my cell phone. And it's my administrative assistant, Tammy. And she's calling me and I pick up and she didn't ever call me that early, and so I'm like, hey, what's going on? She said, Anson, I've got some bad news. She said, Jackie Carter was just killed in a car accident. Jackie Carter was a student in our student ministry. I said, what happened? She said, she was on her way to school. She was driving to school. Car hits her on the highway head on, killed her instantly. She's dead. I get my stuff. I immediately drive over to Jackie's house. I walk in. Dad's not even home from work yet. It's just mom and the rest of the kids. And then I walk in, it's just me. I don't know if you've ever walked in the room where you're the first person to be there when someone's just gotten news like that. I cannot explain to you the sadness and the grief. It's unreal. And I sat next to Jackie's mom. And sometimes the best thing for a Christian to do is just shut up and say nothing. Weep with those who weep. Mourn with those who mourn. And she cried and I cried. And Dad gets home and whole days trying to process this thing. A couple days later, my wife and I go to the viewing and get ready for the funeral and all that stuff. And I remember standing there and I'm looking at Jackie. 17-year-old girl in the casket, went on retreats with us, Mexico mission trips with us, was a student leader, and now she's in a casket. And this guy comes up next to me, and I'd never met this guy before, ever. I had no clue who he was. And he said, he's looking at Jackie, and he says, it's horrible. It's horrible. And I looked at him, I said, yeah, it's awful. And he said, you know, death is just a natural part of life. And everything in me wanted to turn and shake this man. Everything in me wanted to look at him and point a finger at his face and say, what you just said is nonsense. Death is not a natural part of life. Death is the enemy. Read what Paul already said earlier on in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, what he said. He said, the last enemy to die will be death. Death is not our friend. Death is the enemy. Death is not the way that it should be. It's not the way God made things. Read Genesis 1. It's not what God wants. Death is a result of the curse. It's the result of sin. It's the result of our rebellion. It is not God's intent that a parent be standing over the casket of their 17-year-old daughter. That's a result of the curse. That's a result of the fall. It's the enemy, not a friend. A couple months after that, I had a man at that same church come into my office. Man's dying of cancer, has two students in our student ministry, weeping in my office, weeping because he's just gotten, he's just gotten the news. He's only got a couple months to live, and he's weeping in my office. And he says to me, he says, Anson, I am not afraid of dying. I'm not. I know Jesus. I'm not afraid of dying, but I'm terrified of leaving my family behind without me. I'm terrified. That is not a natural part of life. That is not our friend. That's the enemy, family. That's the enemy. And this is what Paul's trying to articulate to us. And this brings us to the very next point. And it's why what Paul's saying here is so needed for Christians and so important for us to understand. Because the next point is this, family. Write this down. Point number 7, I think. Get this. One day soon, because of Jesus, every single Christian will mock death. That's what Paul just said. Paul said, there's coming a day, we're going to hear that trumpet, the dead in Christ will rise. We will come up out of our graves and resurrected, glorified bodies. And then on that day, this saying will be true, death, where's your victory? Death, where's your sting? Man, you were talking a real big game for thousands of years, taking people out. Wait, where are you at now? Who's your daddy now, boy? Who's your daddy? That's seriously... There's coming a day where every Christian gets to mock death. All the pain, all the heartache, all the heartbreak, all the funerals, all the caskets we stood over, all the tears we cried, and we get to mock death. I'm a huge fan of The Simpsons. You can judge me later. I don't care. I'm a huge fan of The Simpsons. Have been for years. It's middle school. My favorite character on The Simpsons is Nelson. Anybody know who Nelson is? Here's what makes Nelson so great. All Nelson does is mock people. And here's how he mocks people. He'll stand up in your face, he'll point at you, and he'll go, ha, ha. I can't wait to do that to death. To stand in the face of death and to mock death, not because we defeated death, because Jesus did. Where's your sting, death? Where's your victory? Death. It looked like you were winning for a long time there, but then Jesus got the final word, and we got to have it with him. It's amazing. And this actually brings us to the 8th point for today, which is this, family. Number eight, non-Christians will die and Christians will die, but only Christians will rise again forever. Non-Christians will die and Christians will die, but only Christians will rise again forever. I remember years ago, watching an interview with Oprah, and Oprah was talking about like sort of her worldview and beliefs on God and everything, and she said, well, I believe the way to God is like a bicycle spoke, right? So bicycle spoke, so you got God in the middle, right? You got God, whoever God, he or she or whatever is, you got God in the middle, and then you can get to, you got all these different spokes, ways to get to, so you can get to God through Jesus, you can get to God through Muhammad, you can get to God through Scientology or through crystals, or you can get to God through Hinduism or Joseph Smith or Confucius and wisdom or reading lots of books. It's all kinds of these different ways to get to God. Here's the problem with that, family. Jesus is the only one of those people who claimed to come down from heaven. Jesus is the only one of them who claimed that he could forgive sin. Jesus is the only one who boldly proclaimed that he is the resurrection and the life, and he's the only one who died and came out of the grave. There is one way to eternal resurrection life, and it is through Jesus who won the victory over death. Maybe you're here today and you've never become a Christian. You've never trusted in Jesus. And you're like, I want this. Like if I have this, if this is my hope, like it changes the way I see everything. It changes the way I see my whole life and see the world. Exactly. Trust in Jesus today. Trust in the good news of the gospel. That Jesus Christ, the King of glory, came out of heaven, lived the perfect life that you could never live, died on a cross that you deserve to die on, and came out of that tomb defeating death, hell, and the devil so that you could have resurrection life forever. Now, here's the deal, beloved. The question that we all have to ask at this point is this. What are we supposed to do now that we know all this? Now that we're aware of that this is our hope as believers, what now, right? In the words of Francis Schaeffer, how shall we then live? What's it all mean? I mean, how should we all live in response to this incredible, magnificent truth that we will have resurrection life forever because of Christ, those of us who love Jesus and know Jesus? Well, this is exactly what Paul's going to say right here at the end. Check this out, family. What should we do with all this information? Paul tells us in verse 58. Watch this, family. Verse 58. Therefore, you know what therefore means? In conclusion. That's what it means. In conclusion. Hey, because of everything I just said, right? Here's why I say everything. Here's what I just said, all that. Here's what all that means. Therefore, in conclusion, here's the point. Therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Translation. The last point. Write it down. Until the day we finally receive our glorified bodies, we are to serve Jesus faithfully. Christian, listen to me. It is not God's ultimate desire for you to just show up on Sundays and sit there and listen to teachings. That is not the end game. It is not God's ultimate desire for you to just take a lawn chair out to your backyard and sit there and wait for the return of Jesus so you can experience his stuff. What's Paul say? Paul says, therefore, because this is all true, you know what you ought to do? Get to work for Jesus. Give yourself to the labor of the Lord, knowing that your labor for the Lord is not in vain. Think about it, family. You got to read the Bible. You got to understand the whole Bible was given to us the way it was given to us for a reason. What's been happening here? In chapter 12, in chapter 13, in chapter 14, what was Paul talking about? Spiritual gifts. That was the whole point, man. Spiritual gifts. Hey, God's given you gifts. So, and they've given you gifts for the local church. Like, you're to use your gifts for the building up of the local body. That God did that. And so follow the train, like he's been calling the church to that, and now he's reminding them of the resurrection of Jesus, the gospel and the resurrection of Jesus and the resurrection of them that is their hope. And then he calls them to, since all this is true, give yourself fully to the Lord. Be steadfast. Use your gifts for the building up of the body of Christ. Follow Jesus, chase after Jesus, pray to Jesus, repent to Jesus, serve Jesus, teach kids for Jesus, come and serve coffee for Jesus. Work in the parking lot for Jesus. Give generously to Jesus. Use your gift for Jesus. Why? Because you know that your labor for Jesus is not in vain. It's not in vain. You don't just do a lot of work for Jesus, die, and then all of it's pointless. No, you do a lot of work for Jesus. You serve Jesus faithfully, and then you die, and then you rise again from the grave forever, and you realize all of it mattered. All of it mattered. So here's my question for you today, beloved. Do you love Jesus? Do you trust Jesus? Is your hope in Jesus? Do you hear this truth about the resurrection life, and is your joy stirred for Jesus? We're going to live forever. Forever. By the way, can I just say this? This is one of the motivations. This is one of the motivators for those of us who have issues with one another. This is one of the motivators for us to forgive and for us to make things right. Because guess what? You're going to be in heaven together a long time. And there's no such thing as a moral weakness. There will be no more fights, no more quibbles, no more issues, no more stuff, drama. No. So get it right today and glorify Jesus and make much of Jesus. We have forever to look forward to. I want to close with this. My favorite old dead preacher, Charles Haddon Spurgeon, was preaching, and it was right after they had just in their church given a funeral for a man who loved Jesus and served everywhere. He was like one of those guys in the church, just always serving and always giving himself and going above and beyond. And his name was Mr. Turner. That's all we know about him. His name is Mr. Turner. And I want to close with something that Charles Spurgeon says about Mr. Turner and about this. 1 Corinthians 15, he says this. We'll put it up on the screen. He says, My brethren, what thoughts of comfort there are in this doctrine that the dead shall rise again. Some of us have this week been standing by the grave and one of our brethren who long served his master in our midst was placed in the tomb. He was a man valiant for truth, indefatigable in labor, self-denying in duty, and always prepared to follow his Lord, Mr. Turner of Lamb and Flag School, and to the utmost of his ability, serviceable to the church. Now, there were tears shed there. Do you know what they were about? There was not a solitary tear shed about his soul. The doctrine of the immortality of the soul was not required to give us comfort, for we knew it well. We were perfectly assured that he had ascended to heaven. The burial service used in the Church of England most wisely offers us no comfort concerning the soul of the departed believer, since that is in bliss, but it cheers us by reminding us of the promised resurrection of the body. And when I speak concerning the dead, it is not to give comfort as to the soul, but as to the body. And this doctrine of the resurrection has comfort for the mourners in regard to the buried mortality. You do not weep, watch this, family. You do not weep because your father, brother, wife, husband has ascended to heaven. You would be cruel to weep about that. None of you weep because your dear mother is before the throne. But you weep because her body is in the grave, because those eyes can no more smile on you, because those hands cannot caress you, because those sweet lips cannot speak melodious notes of affection. You weep because the body is cold and dead and clay-like. For the soul you do not weep, but I have comfort for you. That very body will rise again. That eye will flash with genius again. That hand will be held out in affection once more. Believe me, I'm speaking no fiction. That very hand, that positive hand, those cold clay-like arms that hung down by the side and fell when you uplifted them shall hold a harp one day. And those poor fingers, now icy and hard, shall be swept along the living strings of golden harps in heaven. Yea, you shall see that body once more. Their inbred sins require their flesh to see the dust. But as the Lord their Savior rose, so all his followers must. Will not that remove your tears? He is not dead, but sleepeth. He is not lost. He is seed sown against harvest time to ripen. His body is resting a little while, bathing itself in spices that it may be fit for the embraces of its Lord. What a gift to be a Christian. Let's pray, family. What a gift to be known by Christ. What a gift to taste salvation. What a gift to know that I am his and he is mine. And that I will live forever in glory in the new heavens and the new earth because Jesus, my hero, my champion, has won the victory over death. What a joy to know that because of Jesus, one day those of us who are in Christ will be able to proclaim with all the saints throughout history, death, where is your victory and where's your sting? Where is it? If you've never trusted in Jesus Christ today, can I tell you this? Jesus loves you. He lived the perfect life. He died a death on the cross. He rose again from the grave that you might be forgiven of your many sins. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, all of us. And the only hope we have is in Jesus, our champion, our Savior. And today we're going to have folks in the back of the room, in the back corner near the cross. I myself will be back there. If you want to talk to somebody, if you want to pray, whether you want to trust in Jesus today or whether you're here today and just say, I need to be assured of this hope because I have questions and I struggle and I just want to be prayed for, you are welcome to come to be prayed for. We'd love the privilege of doing that. It's a privilege. What a joy to be a Christian. What a privilege to know Christ. What a joy to worship his name. What a privilege to gather on Sunday. What an amazing thing to be known by Christ. And those of us who follow him and are known by him and are saved by grace, in a moment we'll take the bread representing his body that was nailed to a cross for us. He took on that human flesh and experienced real pain and died for us. We'll taste the cup that represents his blood that was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. And we'll remember not only his atoning death, but the hope we have of glory. our eyes are fixed on Jesus today. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for the promise of resurrection life. Would that be the fuel for mission? Would that be the fuel for obedience? Would that be the fuel for forgiveness and reconciliation? Would that be the fuel for unity in the church? Would that be the fuel for service and generosity? Would that be the fuel that we have resurrection life coming? We're the people of God, saved by Christ, more than conquerors through him who rescued us. Jesus, thank you for your grace and for your love. Pray all these things in your matchless name. Amen.
Spirit, I will rise from the ashes of
Let's pray together. King Jesus, your name is victory. Death does not have the victory, Lord, you do. And in your name, Father, we're promised resurrected life. And we thank you for that, Lord. We revel and worship you for that, Jesus. We thank you for this important reminder this morning. God, I pray for every man and woman in this room, Lord. Would those of us who maybe have been blinded by the eternity of life, Lord, would we remember that this morning? Remember that the grave is not the end. Death is not the end. Our loved ones who have been taken by death, Lord, it's not the end for them. And in you, Lord, we all are offered eternal life, God. We cling to that. We step into that. And God, we pray that our lives would reflect that, that we'd go about abounding in the work of the Lord because the resurrection's coming, Father, for us as well. Jesus, you are a great God and a perfect Savior, and we rest in you this morning. I pray now for, Father, the gifts that'll be given this morning, the offerings that'll be given this week online. Lord, I pray over them. I pray that the generosity of your people would be met with your eternal power, Lord, to continue to advance your church, to build your kingdom, to let the gates of hell be pushed back by the glorious truth of the resurrection. Do it, Jesus, with your power. It's in your name that we pray together this morning. Amen. Amen, family. You can have a quick seat. Got a few announcements for us as we prepare to depart. Got a lot of stuff coming up. Here we are. It's August 1st. Y'all don't know how that happened, but a lot of stuff coming up. You'll hear about in the weeks ahead. Missional community groups coming back. Bible study environments coming back soon. But a few things we want to let you know about going on this week. First off, we need a drummer. We actually need several drummers. So a little bit of a random announcement there. But if you have the gift of drumming, we could use your help. So if God has blessed you in that way, reach out to Pastor Jeremy. He'd love to walk you through what that looks like. And honestly, if God's gifted you musically in a lot of other ways as well, we'd love to have you as a part of our worship team. So just be aware there's some needs there. And then also, Growth Track is coming up. Want to make sure you know about this environment. That kicks off August 15th, so 2 weeks from today. This is an environment for you if you are newer to our church and looking to figure out more about who we are as Emmaus Church. So what does it look like to be a covenant member here? Why are we called Emmaus? What do we believe as a church? How to get connected here deeply in serving and in growing here in our body? We'd love to walk you through all of that. It kicks off, like I said, in 2 weeks. You can get all the details online, emmausbible.com/growthtrack. I want to encourage you to jump into that. And I also want to just say this, if anybody, maybe you're not new, maybe you've been here for quite some time. The last year, 18 months has been weird, sort of the COVID time warp I know we've all experienced. But if you've never jumped into membership with us, we'd love to encourage you to take Growth Track, walk through this class with us. We'd love to explore that process with you, see if this is the place where God's calling you to covenant with us as a church family as we go about this work that God's called us to. So jump into that if that applies to you. And with that, family, let me read our benediction, which comes from that last verse that Anson preached. I think it's the perfect way for us to conclude. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Go abound, family. We love you. We'll see you next week.
Hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling